You know, I've had the opportunity of flying 85 types of aircraft. This was a pride because this is the confidence the Air Force gave me. God has been kind and things have fallen in place with me, and I achieved the maximum that I could possibly in the Air Force. And then I retired with about 6,300 hours of flight. That when we flew the aircraft, we flew for the pride within ourselves. And I remember, piston engine, we were always told by our instructor, use that control column as though it was your best girlfriend. Use it gently. But that pride should be there. So we opted for the armed forces, and in the armed forces, circumstances and various things took me to the Air Force. And I think this was fortuitous, because I had no hesitation in saying that when I was in the Prince of Wales Military College, or when I was in the first course of the JSW, I was a very average person academically. Not excelling or getting any medals. But then when I joined the Air Force, it was on 6 January 1951. And within a year and a month or so, that is 15th March 1952, I was commissioned. I found that suddenly my whole fortune had turned, and I had become an academy under officer, and I was in good shape, and I never looked back. So, putting these two aside, let me just tell you that I had the good fortune. I was in Dasi, the Directorate of Air Staff Inspection. Again, I volunteered and I was attached to Service Squadron. Therefore, all the three wars, I was with Service Squadron. It was sad, though Bunny Coelho, who was the OC, had to eject. And he was prisoner of war, I think. So I took over command of 7th Squadron. We went to Jaisalmer. From there I rang up air headquarters, since I had my contact there even as a wing commander. And so we moved to Pathankot. And that was very lovely, that area. I have a letter of congratulation from Lieutenant General Sartaj, who was in charge of GOC in that area. I'll show you my logbook over there. And it's from my... Dandekar was the station commander, group captain, but then they sent Air Commodore Katre, who later became chief, to the overall commander. I have a letter, personal letter from him also on this. This was a very professional war. This was a very professional war. The chief was P.C. Lal, Air Chief Marshal P.C. Lal. What went on in the air headquarters on the Army, Navy and the Air Force front to combine is a difficult chapter now. You see, Sam Manekshaw, General Sam Manekshaw, He in his book, it's evident that he was speaking to the Prime Minister all the time. It didn't sort of mention where the other chiefs were. But I know for a certain that Prime Minister Indira Gandhi would not speak to only one chief, she would speak to all three chiefs. So books and the things can be taken for whatever they are worth. And I think there could be no better display of inter-services understanding and cooperation than in 1971. Now this had two dimensions. One was on the Eastern Front and the other was on the Western Front. I was in the Western Front. So we did a lot of close support sorties, etc., and bombing fuel dumps, etc., and storage dumps. We feel that we did well enough, but it depends. Once again, as I said, never ask old chap, he'll always make some claim or the other. So we did this, and this force was very effectively fought in the West, and the bulk of the Air Force or the Pakistani Air Force was in the West. So we did not allow them to take anything from us. In the Eastern sector, where this warfare took place, I want to particularly mention that time Wing Commander Bishnoi, B.K. Bishnoi. He was the OC of 28th Squadron. And I've known this officer because he was with junior to me, and he was with me in the AEB, he was with me in 20th Squadron. He was a very fine aviator. I'll say in many ways crazy, because I remember his main compass had failed in one of the operations in 1965. And he said on the E2 compass, you remember the E2 compass which we had that? He, on that he flew into enemy territory. This is really crazy. I wouldn't have done it myself. He's V. Chakrabar, and he's the man who not only bombed the governor's house, but also, the Dhaka airport. And then to crown it all, he had the gumption to do a loop on Dhaka airfield. I'm told that when they were invited to Dhaka or something, he had gone along. And Bangladeshi Air Force chap, who was originally the Pakistani fellow, he was asking, who's that crazy fellow who was doing a loop over us? So the story, as far as the East is concerned, was the highlight was that the Air Force softened all the targets for them, and the Army marched in. Net result, 93,000 prisoners of war. It's debatable. The subsequent action between Bhutto and Indira Gandhi, whether these 93,000 could not have been played for POK and to resolve the JNK problem once and for all. My school of thought is that it should have been used. But we gave it gratis to them. So whatever is the political reason, I can't comment, but I'm talking only as a military man. And I found that 71 war was most gratifying. And I had the privilege of serving under really person like Air Commodore Khatre. We just said, you saw that, take the aircraft and go. I mean, we weren't waiting for air headquarters permission or anything. I think the role of the Army, Navy and the Air Force was extremely creditable. Because even Western powers were anti. Britain had to withdraw its forces, its naval ships. But the Air Force sustained. It goes to show one character of the Air Force, which I mentioned in one of my interviews on Abhinandan. You see, you say that he is flying a flying coffin or something, MiG-21. The pilot does not think that way. He is flying a machine. He knows all the parameters are normal, he takes off. And you could have fifth generation aircraft, you may have to punch out exactly 5 seconds after rolling. So there is no risk. So this is known as resilience. What we bank on in the Air Force is to make this person very resilient, which means to say, he's not bothered about this. He has professionalism in him. He knows his competence. And this I must also share with you without being too immodest. You know, I've had the opportunity of flying 85 types of aircraft. That is because of Dasi, AAB and CNC and Chief. Nobody could tell me. I have flown all the brands of the helicopter and transport aircraft as captain. And when I was a chief, when I flew the Boeing also myself as captain to my inspection to the various stations. And the helicopter same way. So I flew all the brands of these things. And this was a pride because this is the confidence the Air Force gave me. Yes. And then I retired with about 6,300 hours of flying, which is not bad. I would really like to speak for the succeeding generations of the in the Air Force that this is a service you can be very, very proud of. What you have to do is to build up your confidence and your resilience. For you, it should not be important which is the vintage of the aircraft you're flying. It is important what is the mission ahead of you. And there's no better service than the Air Force to fly this. Not only because you can fly at giddy heights above there and be that much closer to God, but literally speaking, this is the only service that has so much of power with it that it can help in the overall decision of how a future war is going to be won. And I wish you all the best. God bless you. And may God's blessings always be with you. Fly well and serve India, our greatest country in the world today. Thank you.